According to Rutherford and to Dunbar. From this reaction, there is a very big reality. And it has a very great importance. This simple reaction includes all mathematics we have heard all until now these days. It is very simple, but includes too much But there is a factor which is very, very important. And this factor can be understood for a simple person who doesn't know any mathematics. There is a missing of energy. There is a huge energy which cannot be explained with this reaction. Professor Santilli is not in fact beyond the experimental verification. He noticed that in the stars made from pure hydrogen, we have a huge creation of neutrons in the core of the star. But there is a missing energy. Where this energy comes from? So, Professor Santilli proposed that there is a process, a particle process, not just a particle process, through which this reaction can take place. This originates from ether, and for this reason is named etherine. There is a very big difference between this and this. And here we can see that there is a revolution. Why? Because this reaction requires ether. And ether is against the standard model. You can see, we can notice that it is possible to be within the mainstream of mathematics and nobody to opposite our point of view. But when we go to physics and we say that this is ether, in that case the problem is very complicated. It becomes almost political. Yes. According to this, we have ether. What is ether? A universe substrate. But nobody who follows relativity theory can accept that there is ether. But this kind of ether can be explained through hadronic mechanics. But the question is raised. Since it comes from ether, the question is raised, what is ether? What is this substrate? What I can do is to tell some things according to a minimum contradiction physics. I'll tell you a few words about it. When we state a theory, beyond the axioms of theory itself, we use language. But also language has some axioms. Classical logic, the sufficient reason of reason. And one hidden axiom, according to which we don't speak simultaneously. We don't speak simultaneously, one word after another. Therefore, any theory includes principles of language plus further axioms of theory. It can be proved a theorem according to which any system which includes the logic lambda and a statement which is not theorem of logic lambda leads to a contradiction. Lambda means classical logic plus the sufficient reason principle in the form of a complete probability principle. In that case, our communication is contradictory. This implies science. The most consistent attitude is silence. However, we continue to communicate. We persist in logic. This means that we act under the claim for minimum contradictions. That is, we use logic, but we have in our mind the fact that the contradictions are present. I would like to add something I forgot to previously. I feel that this conference has a similarity with Himalaya. Himalaya is very hard. Also, this conference is very hard. And therefore, it could be regarded as a movement because it can apply in science, pure science, applied science, and technology under the leadership of Professor Sandeep.
He coined the word Himalaya Sandeep.
There we go.
Because we are our science, yeah. We are beyond the 20th century science. By full respecting them, of course.
Yes. It's time for them to retire.
Of a closed system is constant.
Okay.
On this basis, we can have the operators, space-time operators. We can have the Schrödinger's relativistic equation, which simple mathematics, but under this form we have fractal space-time, which is different from this. And fractal space-time is characterized by the property of self-similarity. Perhaps this has relation to canonical, but it has to be searched. Here is the conservation law, the momentum conservation. And here we have the space-time geometry on the basis of the psi wave function, which means this is the matter geometry, fractal geometry. And this is relative time, and this is relative length in a direction m. Here is the gravitational acceleration written in the form in terms of probability density. It is noted that this gravitational acceleration under certain simplification is compatible to Newton or to relativistic equation. But this is more general. In this kind of equation, fractal equations, not simply Schrödinger equations, it is possible to, for a closed system, it is possible to go to this inequality, which means that the energy produced is always bigger than zero, which is compatible to dS bigger than zero. But according to the minimum contradictions, the energy is equivalent to time. And this is the passing time, which means the arrow of time. Thus, the arrow of time is compatible to the entropy production. And this implies the irreversibility. I have heard Professor Animalou. I have heard you, Professor, during your speech, that the CP violation is an important thing related to hadronic mechanics. I'd like to add that, of course, I don't know how safe are these informations. I have read that it has been announced from Fermilab Tevatron that there is a dominance pattern over antimatter, which means during the Vita meson decay, we have more muons than antimuons. This is compatible with hadronic mechanics. But it is also compatible according to minimum contradictions. Because if we say matter with psi minus, charge of electron minus, and plus charge of positron, and this is regarded, the charge itself is regarded as imaginary mass. So it has energy. Itself, the charge itself, behaves as mass. Therefore, we have this equation, and we have that there is a difference between matter and antimatter equal to the gravitational energy, which is bigger than zero. Therefore, matter dominates over antimatter. I think this is compatible to hadronic mechanics.
Would that be Cuchin matrix?
Sadin's reaction is very important because for the notions, common notions of geometry and energy, we go to the notion of ether, which is in contrast to standard model. So we have to give as more as possible verifications of the gravitational and the electromagnetic interaction. Here, this is zero voltage, high voltage. This is the intensity of the electric field. And since here we have negative charges, we have an upward. This can be. This has been experimentally verified. And it is noted that there is not any current because we have not corona effect. Therefore, the power is zero. With zero power, we have an upward movement. This means that the electrical field, when coexists with the gravitational, interacts. It was very amazing. For this reason, I would like to verify it, and I made this mechanism. I noticed that this mechanism is not always working. Sometimes works. We have not reproducibility. But when it works, the weight loss is very important. Uh, we try to understand why, and through this analysis we found that we cannot activate these places, and for this reason it needs a modification. However, even in that case, the forces are not very important. For this reason, it would be very important to study a magnetic system. This is superconductor. This is magnet. We have magnetic lines circulating this way. We know from the Meissner effect that there is a repulsion between magnetic field and superconductor. Therefore, the magnetic field pushes forward this direction the whole mechanism. And the problem raised, and which is compatible with the Ferrino problem, is that where is coming from the magnetic energy which creates the current vortex pinning forces? Where does it come from? From ether. And therefore, from ether becomes this magnetic pinning force, and here the area becomes weaker and denser, and therefore, according to this law of acceleration, according to probabilities, we have this motion. But of course, this must be verified. I think that there is a person here, very important member, Dr. Liu Ying, who could do something about it. And of course, with the contribution of the Himalaya movement.
Yes.
These bosons require Higgs boson. Santini's reaction could be regarded as an inverse reaction, inverse to Newton decay. In that case, the Ferrino should imply an inverse action of W and Z, and of course of Higgs boson, or Higgs-like boson. Now, there is a very important point. In the Fermi lab temperature, they announced that if really we have dominance of matter over matter, and we cannot find Higgs boson, we need a new model. This is the time you are expecting. According to this point of view, we don't need Higgs boson. We have just an interaction between G and electromagnetics. It's enough. Of course, provided that the minimum contradiction point of view can give explanations to Santini-Seferino, the question is raised of how the minimum contradictions equation are compatible to Hadronic mechanics, which means a verification. Of course, references. Santini, here is a book I have written. Many other. Here we have also experimental verification by Kanarev. He's a Russian, Kanarev, for light water electrolysis. And here, light water electrolysis by Randall Mills. Here we have a reference from Kozirev radiation, which means that space has an interaction with matter itself. Kozirev. this is also. Also, in the same spirit is a work of Cynthia Whitney. Of course, I have said that in our effort to produce convergent nodes made from superconductor, this is compatible to Sandilli's reaction, compatible to Korda's work on gravitomagnetism, and perhaps compatible to Liu Ying works, Kleister, which is a very, very nice book related to twin universes, to negative energy which can contribute in the change of the probability density. Here we have the announcement from CERN related to Higgs, because they already say that perhaps there is not Higgs. And here is a book for which I thank deeply Professor Sandilli and Mrs. Sandilli for making me the honor to publish this work, where all these are written in detail. As you can see here, this is a landscape produced by Mandelbrot. And it is not real, but looks like real. This is fractal. This is why we put this picture to the front.
This here in this impeccable of classical part, where touch the imaginary part, and in this way, automatically we selected the first and the second. If you reverse, I think you find the converse antimatter dominated matter.
It's very true.
Also, about this interaction between electrical field, magnetic field, to the gravitational field. Why? Because they are of the same nature. They produce mechanical work. They have this common property. It was a big deal in France after 1970, to look magnetic field E, electric field E, and magnetic field H. What are vector fields, like we say now in our discussion, or are one forms? One forms means something which produces mechanical work. Because you take integral, pass integral of the second type from one form, and this is mechanical work. Right. And they discovered that, I don't remember now the author of this kind of papers, but it has very important papers in this direction showing that the electric fields and magnetic field are in fact one forms. So they produce mechanical work like the gravitational field. Being in the same class, they must interact. This is sure. About this idea with superconductors. Okay. In my opinion, if you put superconductors in a suitable geometry, geometry means, for example, to put in this way another in another direction, another in another direction, you create around a field which is capable to do all you want. What I have in mind, what happened, yes, but you change the superconductor put in a suitable geometry. For example, in a skew rectangle. And you create a suitable field around it. Why? Why? In 69, Iofe from Russia created the first magnetic trap.
The first magnetic?
Magnetic trap.
What is it?
To preserve plasma around the sun. So, combination of plasma.
Thank you.
So, okay. And at the same time, in the United States, spent a lot of time creating a big magnet with a point in interior, central point, where the magnetic field is not zero, but the energy is minimum. They created this big magnet, but they failed. No preserving of plasma. And Iofe from Russia put two anti-Helmholtz coils in this way and some rectilinear wires around. He introduced power and succeeded in preserving plasma. And this was the first model of Iofe to preserve plasma around the point for a few seconds. Not for a very little time, not an extended time. And this is a very great idea because it's coming from the school of Paris. One of the professors in Romania who studied in Paris, Saba Ștefănescu, was a geophysicist. And he explained to me, Constantin, put rectilinear wires, electrical rectilinear wires, in a suitable geometry. And sure, you will create a magnetic field around, very elementary magnetic field, not complicated, but it has the property to do something. In my mind was to add near these configurations, near these geometrical configurations, to add geometry of the space. And geometry of the space in my mind is Riemannian geometry, so something to do lengths, something to do derivations, something to do potential, Young's potential, gravitational potential, and so on and so on. And I succeeded in making a theory regarding this, of course, and also I involved the optimal control theory to control preservation of plasma around the point in interior of this state.
Okay, please, I would like to ask you
please
the question. Here we have a propulsion creation.
Yes.
Do you think that it is possible?
Yes. Yes.
This is enough for us.
So very important comments, sir.
So just a moment. Just a moment. Professor.
The chairman has to be generous in time. Fundamental problem.
Exactly.
We cannot sacrifice science for time. No.
I would like to tell you that.
No, lunch can wait. What
I try to do is to find the consequences according to the claim for reading contradictions. It does not derive from any observation.
Yes,
it derives from pure mental principles. And it is important if the pure mental principles can meet experimental and other points of view. Of course,
I have a few comments which are important. Sorry for time. No. But this is one of the very fundamental talk for this from this entire lecture, the entire train of thought. Point number one, throughout the entire 20th century, it has believed that the ether as a universal substratum is in contradiction with Einstein's special relativity, as you correctly recall. Now, for me, Einstein's special relativity is sacred, its validity in vacuum is unquestionable. Now, but I believe vacuum is a universal medium. I do not believe that universal substratum is in violation of Einstein's relativity. Why? Because for us, it's impossible to identify this famous or infamous privilege reference frame at rest with the vacuum. It's impossible even to conceive an experiment. Since we cannot conceive an experiment that can identify the reference frame at rest with the ether, I believe, contrary to the entire 20th century, sorry, I want to be independent thinker, I believe that the ether as a universal substratum is indeed compatible with Einstein's special relativity. It's my personal opinion. Number two, 50 years ago, the famous ethereal wind was disproved as being political. This was the statement by Professor Sigges. The electron is a vibration of what? If I don't say it on the ether, it is a legend. We do politics. You hear my voice because there is air. You see my face because there is a medium. Electromagnetic waves are a wave. If we do waves without a medium, ladies and gentlemen, this is politics. That's me. It's theology. A wave cannot exist unless you have a medium. So there's a beautiful point by Professor Nazir. The electron, when you move an electron, you move the oscillation from this point to another point. This is 50 years ago. When you move the sand from here, you move the characteristic vibration of the ether from this other, the ethereal wave cannot exist. I have one final point that I would like to clarify. The etherino came up as a mandatory. But we are not sure, of course. So we need your viewpoint, not approval. No, we're interested in science, not in why it came up mandatory. It is very deep political, very deep philosophical implication. It implies continuous creation in our universe. Why it came about? Well, the argument is the form, the evidence is the form. You have a star, all hydrogen. Only hydrogen, pure hydrogen. Stars, this is evidence. Stars initiated being pure hydrogen. Evidence number one. Evidence number two, star must first synthesize the neutron. Unless they synthesize the neutron, all other nuclear reactions are impossible. Because from the neutron, you synthesize the deuterium, and then the helium, and so on. So without synthesizing the neutron, everything else is impossible. Now, question. Every synthesis of the neutron requires just about 1 million electron volts. Evidence. At the beginning of when this majestic episode, when the star begins to produce light, the star synthesized 10 to the 50, 10 to the small star, a big star 10 to the 70 neutron. Question. We're talking about we miss 10 to the 50 or 10 to the 70 MeV. Where this energy is coming from? Now, at that moment, immediately everybody, all people who are interested in preserving, in adapting nature to preferred theories, immediately say, oh, this missing energy comes from the interior of the star. But here is the problem. If this orthodox view is correct, a star will never initiate to produce light, because it will lose 10 to the 50, 10 to the 70 MeV per second. So where is this energy coming from? In this majestic event, which is the creation of the light, this is the Bible. Professor Ying, this, you are a religious person, you believe the creation, light, God created light first. So this is the open problem. We have found no alternative, and I beg you, if you find any alternative, will disprove this argument. You have my own point. This is a fundamental issue for you, for scientific knowledge. We find no, after looking for years and years, no other alternative than the ether propagating to the electron and proton. Everything is missing, not only energy, the spin, everything else. Now, and consequently, it became mandatory to assume the ether as a universal substratum with an enormous amount of energy. Do the calculation, 1 cm³ contains more energy than the entire energy contained in the sun. Please, this is a crucial, if you have any objection, I'll have my utmost appreciation. But you have a very fundamental talk, Professor Sigges. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Beautiful talk.
Yes.
Beautiful, actually.